The Churches of Christ present Bible Talk.
There are many things that we may receive in this life as an inheritance. And generally these are things that we cherish, things that we hold dear. But you know, the greatest inheritance is not an earthly inheritance at all. The greatest inheritance is the Christian inheritance. And that's our topic of study today. So stay tuned after this song of praise. Hello again, and thank you for tuning in to Bible Talk. It's with great joy and thankfulness that we welcome you to our program today. And as always, it's our goal to provide biblical teaching, sharing the truth of God's Word with the world. And we pray that these truths find you today in the best of health, both physically and spiritually. Thank you for allowing us to share God's Word with you today. You know, whether we realize it or not, all of us have been a part or a recipient, we should say, of some kind of inheritance. It may be that we've inherited land or perhaps even a home. It may be that our inheritance has been an inheritance of finances or investments. Maybe of some family heirlooms like furniture or pictures, recipe books, and so on. But you know, really an inheritance can go beyond these physical possessions. And an inheritance, as we think about it, can be in reference to things like our memories that we've inherited, things that we've have been passed down to us about our ancestors, and we can continue to share those memories in with others. We all have an inheritance of examples to either follow in the positive sense or examples to be avoided. And at the very least, every person has inherited a name. All of us wear a family name, and that name carries with it certain connotations, you know, and so we've inherited some aspects of our name. But you know, there is an inheritance that surpasses all of these. It's an inheritance not from our earthly fathers, but from our Heavenly Father. It's the Christian inheritance. It's this inheritance that's the inheritance of a home, not a dwelling place here on earth, but that eternal home that Jesus is preparing for all of His children, John 14:1-6. It's the Christian inheritance that is the inheritance of spiritual blessings, which are far greater than any material blessings or things of this life. And it's the inheritance of a name, not the name of our fathers, but the name that comes from God, the name Christian. I want to notice with you today in this lesson what Peter says about the Christian inheritance in 1 Peter 1 in verses 3 through 5. I want to read the text with you first, and then we'll make some points from what Peter says. In 1 Peter 1, beginning at verse 3, Peter by inspiration says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible, undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed in the last time. I want to notice with you first that from Peter's writing, we see that the Christian inheritance is a result of God's abundant mercy. That's where Peter begins. He says, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy has given these things to us." Salvation and all of its blessings are ultimately a result of God's abundant mercy. I want you to take a moment and think about the mercy of God. We see His mercy even from the very beginning in Genesis chapter 3. You know that in that chapter, this is when sin entered into the world and Adam and Eve partook of the forbidden fruit and therefore violated God's law. Sin entered into the world and death by sin. But you remember that God had told man that in the day that you eat thereof, ye shall surely die. There's a lot of debate about what exactly that means. Did God mean that man would die that instant? Or are we talking about a spiritual separation? Or are we just talking about that man would begin to die, that consequence of sin that is now passed upon all men? In either case, based on the text, we know that God would have been just, God would have been perfectly within His rights to destroy man at that very moment. But He didn't. From the very beginning, from the time that sin entered into the world, we also see God's mercy enter into the world. And He ushers in His eternal plan, that scheme of redemption, whereby man would be bought back or redeemed unto Him through the sacrifice of His Son. But you also see God's mercy again in the universal judgment of the world in Genesis chapter 6. The tone and the tenor of the chapter seems to indicate that God initially had it set in mind to completely destroy humanity from the face of the earth. And then you have that small word, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. And again, you see God's mercy enter in when there's a time of judgment. And when God's mercy came to Noah and to his house, He gave him the instructions for the preparing of the ark and saved those 8 righteous souls in the ark. You see His mercy time and time again in dealing with Israel, a very stiff-necked nation, a people who complained and murmured often, and yet God was merciful with them time and time again. And the greatest act, the greatest show of His mercy is found in probably the greatest known passage in all of the Bible, John 3 and verse 16. John said, "God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." That little word "so" is an indicator of God's abundant mercy. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. What greater sign, what greater show of mercy could there ever be? We see His mercy in dealing with the writer of our text, Peter. Luke 22, 54 through 62, we have where Peter denied the Lord 3 times the night of his arrest. And yet it would be this same Peter who would stand up later on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2 and declare, "That same Jesus whom ye have crucified, God has now made both Lord and Christ." It would be this Peter that would declare, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins." Peter himself being a recipient of God's abundant mercy. As we think about His abundant mercies, we're reminded what Moses said in the long ago, when Moses said, "It is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed, and they are new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness." Lamentations 3, 22 and 23. And surely His mercies never come to an end. The psalmist mentioned often the tender mercies of God. You can't read through the book of Psalms without being reminded of God's mercies over and over and over again. It's His mercies that continue to see the forgiveness of any and all sin. Think about that. In 1 Corinthians 6 and verses 9 through 11, we read about some of the abominable acts that the Corinthians had been involved with. Fornications and drunkenness and adultery and homosexuality and idolatry and all of these things. And yet Paul was able to write, "And such were some of you," past tense. That's what you used to be. But now you're sanctified. Now you're justified. How? Because of God's mercy. It's God's mercy that sees Saul of Tarsus, a persecutor of the church and of all those who would call upon the name of Christ. Forgiven. This Saul of Tarsus, who had consented to the death of God's own servant and Stephen, this Saul of Tarsus who was on his way to a city to carry other men and women to prison, and yet out of God's abundant mercy, he's forgiven and he's changed. He becomes the Apostle Paul, writer of 2/3 of our New Testament. It's out of this abundant mercy that the world continues to go on existing today. 2 Peter 3 and verse 9, Peter says, "The Lord is not slack concerning His promises, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, we're not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance." The whole theme of 2 Peter chapter 3 is that the day of judgment is going to come. There are people who are asking, when is judgment coming? When's the Lord going? We've been waiting for this, you know, from the beginning, and it hasn't come yet. And Peter reminds them that God is not slack concerning His promises. And the fact is that the only reason judgment has not already come is because of the abundant mercy of God. And every day that the world continues to exist is a day where men have a chance to repent and be redeemed unto God. The inheritance for the children of God, the Christian inheritance, is a result of the abundant mercy of our God. And friends, out of that mercy, He has given us an inheritance that is a living hope. And that's the second point of our lesson. The Christian inheritance is the result of God's abundant mercy. But then number two, the Christian inheritance is a living hope. Peter says in 1 Peter 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively," or a living, "hope." You put yourself in the shoes of the apostles, Peter and the others, and you think about how they had surely had their hopes dashed when Jesus died on the cross. You know, you put yourself in their shoes and you've been with the Lord now for 3.5 years, give or take, of His earthly ministry. And now He's told you that He's going to a place where you cannot at this time follow. And even later on, when we come to the book of Acts, we see that they don't still really understand. They're wanting to know, will You now at this time restore the kingdom of Israel to His glory? And they stand there gazing up into the heavens until they have to be told, hey, in like manner, He's going to return. It's time to get to work. But after all they'd been through, after all that they had seen and witnessed when Jesus was crucified and when He went into the grave, don't you know that they felt, at least in that moment, hopeless? But friends, they had been born again unto a living hope. To be begotten again is to be born again. Their hope had been revived. Their hope was now living and active. And friends, there is a truth reinforced for us here that hope comes to those who have been born again. Salvation is often expressed in Scripture in this way. And sometimes people will say, "I'm a born-again Christian," as if being born again and being Christian are two separate things, when they're not. If one is born again, they are a Christian, and vice versa. We know that because in John chapter 3, when Nicodemus came to Jesus at night, Jesus said, "Except a man be born again, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven." Peter here is telling us that hope, their hope had been revived, their hope had been born again, but that born again hope only comes to those who have been born again. The question then is, how is one born again? Well, Peter tells us in this same chapter the answer to that question. In 1 Peter 1, 22 and 23. It's here where Peter says, "Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever." Peter says here that being born again is the purifying of our souls through obeying the truth through the incorruptible Word of God, which lives and abides forever. That means, friends, that in order for me to be born again, I must be obedient to the incorruptible Word of God. obeying those initial commands to have faith, Hebrews 11:6, to repent of my sins, Acts 17 and verse 30, to confess my faith in Christ, Romans 10, 9 and 10, and to be baptized, fully immersed, to have my sins washed away, Acts 22, 16, 1 Peter 3:21. And having obeyed those commands, I'm born again, and not only am I born again, but I receive this born again, this living hope, this hope that has come from God out of His abundant mercy. When one has been born again, like Peter, the fires of hope are kindled and made alive. This living hope that the one who has obeyed the gospel receives is mentioned as one of the three great gifts at the end of 1 Corinthians 13. Faith, hope, and love, these things He's given to us. This living hope will never make us ashamed, Romans 5 and verse 5. This living hope is an everlasting comfort, an everlasting consolation that we have from God, 2 Thessalonians 2, verse 16. This living hope serves so oftentimes as the anchor of our souls, Hebrews 6, 18 and 19. The reason, friends, that hope exists, the reason that it's possible, is because it comes from God's abundant mercy. It comes when we've been born again, but it's ultimately possible because of the resurrection of Christ. Third thing that we need to notice is that the Christian inheritance is possible by the resurrection of Christ. Peter says in verse 3, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to His abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope," notice, "by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." In essence, Peter is here saying that hope is available, our inheritance is available, God's mercy is available because Christ was raised from the dead. Peter, the apostles, everyone that has ever lived, those who are living now, and any who will ever live, would be completely hopeless if it were not for the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. Time would not permit us today to go and to read all of this from 1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 22. But let me encourage you to spend some time with that text to understand and to meditate upon Paul's words, which show in 1 Corinthians 15 just how hopeless and helpless we would be without the resurrection of Christ. Just to give you a simple breakdown of 1 Corinthians 15, 12 through 22, Paul says in verse 14, that if it were not for the resurrection of Christ, if Christ be not raised from the dead, all preaching is vain, verse 14. In fact, there really is no gospel message at all if Christ is not raised from the dead. The word gospel means literally good news, and if Jesus is still in the grave, friends, there is no good news to share. In verse 15, Paul says that if Christ be not raised from the dead, the apostles are liars. We can throw this book out. We can throw out everything that they wrote, everything that they said, because they made it all up. They're liars if Christ isn't raised from the dead, because they are eyewitnesses to such an account. If Christ be not raised from the dead, verse 17, all faith is vain. Our faith, that which we walk by faith and not by sight. That which upholds everything else, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. All of that's vain if Christ be not raised from the dead. All men are still lost in their sins, verse 17, if Christ be not raised from the dead. If Christ died and remains in the grave, friends, there is no forgiveness for our sins. There's no reunion with those that have gone on before us, verse 18. And we are above all men most miserable, verse 19. Think about what all Paul has told us there in that text. Preaching is vain, faith is vain, we have no forgiveness of our sins, no reunion with our loved ones, and we are above all men most miserable if Christ is not raised from the dead. Think about this further, that if Christ is not raised from the dead, then Christ Himself lied. In Matthew 12 and verse 40, He said He was going to give them the sign of Jonah. Just as Jonah spent 3 days in the belly of the whale, so the Son of Man must spend 3 days in the earth. But then He was going to be raised. In Matthew 16 and verse 21, He told His disciples about the things which He should suffer and that He should die and be buried and rise again the third day. But if that didn't come to pass, And Christ Himself was not telling the truth. If Christ is not raised from the dead, according to Romans 1, 3 through 4, there's no power declaring Him as the Son of God. And sadly, there are so many people that believe this. Atheists, agnostics, skeptics, those who doubt. But Paul and Peter, along with the host of other witnesses, proclaim Christ is raised from the dead. In fact, that's where Paul goes in 1 Corinthians 15. He says, if Christ be not raised, this is what all we have to consider, but Christ is raised from the dead. Friends, the truth is that the tomb was empty 3 days later, and it's still empty today. And Hebrews 1 and verse 3 tells us that He's seated at the right hand of the Majesty on high. We don't have to worry about this hope. We don't have to worry about our inheritance falling short or being taken away, because it's made possible by the resurrection of Christ, and because of that, it is reserved in heaven. In verse 4 of 1 Peter 1, Peter says, we have been given this inheritance, which is incorruptible, undefiled, that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you. The idea of our inheritance is that it is guarded, it is protected and reserved. Paul asked, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress, persecution or famine, nakedness or peril or sword? Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through Him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Romans 8, 38 and 39. People, trials, Satan, sin, and even death itself cannot destroy the Christian inheritance. Now, we can destroy our inheritance. We can turn away from God and thereby lose that inheritance that has been reserved for us. We can reject the gospel message and lose it. But friends, outside of that, our inheritance is incorruptible. That is, it's without decay. Earthly things rust and rot and ruin, but not our inheritance. Our inheritance is undefiled. The word undefiled means without defilement. Our inheritance is pure and clean, and our inheritance will never fade away. That word unfading is a Greek word that was used oftentimes in Greek literature to describe a mythical flower that was always in bloom and magnificence. Our inheritance is an unfading, ever-blooming inheritance. That's why we sing the song, "Where the Roses Never Fade." And friends, it is forever waiting on the faithful. How wonderful it is to know as a child of God, when we pillow our heads, that if our eyes were to close in this life and open in the next, that our reservation is made and the price has been paid. Yes, Peter's words here are among the most beautiful in all of the Scriptures as he describes the Christian inheritance. It's only possible through the abundant mercy of God. It is a living and an active hope and a hope that's been born again to those who have been born again. And it is alive and well through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and it is reserved in heaven. The final thought that I want to leave with you is the last two words of verse 4 when Peter says it's reserved in heaven for you. Peter said this is for you. That means it's personal. And so we end this lesson on that personal note. And I ask you the question today, is the Christian inheritance for you? If not, why not? If because you've never obeyed the gospel, won't you obey those simple commands? Won't you be born again, to be born again unto that living hope? If you've obeyed the gospel, but you know you've strayed away, you've not remained faithful, won't you come home? The Father's watching, the Father's waiting, and He's saying, come home. Won't you do that today? I pray that this lesson's been a blessing to you. Thank you again for tuning in today. And God bless. you have any questions about the Bible? Are you searching for a place to worship God like you find in the Bible? Do you have questions about your eternity? Would you like to know more about God's plan for you? Let me encourage you to visit a Church of Christ near you today. And if you're interested in learning more about the Lord's Church, we also offer free material. For more information, or if you would like to have a transcript or a copy of today's program, whether audio or video, please go to our website at www.bible-talk.org, or you can email us at bible.talk@bible-talk.org. You can also write to us at Bible Talk, P.O. Box 40, Fayette, Alabama, 35555. Simply include the program number, and we'll be happy to send that to you completely free of charge. Thank you again for tuning in, and may God bless you richly in your walk with Him. Singing provided by the Edmond Church of Christ, Edmond, Oklahoma, producers of In Search of the Lord's Way. You can visit their website at www.searchtv.org.